So, let's start, because we are already a bit late. Welcome. I will talk a bit about Java EE. I will talk a bit about Kubernetes. And as you heard, I'm not English native speaker. I'm from Switzerland, actually. Coming here to GCon, I would say, if I remember correctly, I'm the third time here the last couple of 4 years, so quite regularly. It's a great conference, always speaking here. I also have some other hobbies. I'm working as principal consultant at a company in Switzerland, which is also do some business in Germany and Austria, and even Denmark. I'm currently the spec lead of the MoneyJSR. I'm some kind of lazy expert group, very lazy expert group member in the CDI2 expert group, working as different projects, as mostly as architect, with architectural stuff and questions sometimes, but also get hands dirty as engineer, really doing real stuff. As you see, working for Apache, I have that some kind of projects. One is about configuration. There you see Twitter and email addresses if you want to get in touch with me. The agenda today. First, we will start a bit unusually with some history of Java, how all this was starting 20 years ago somehow. Go over into Java EE just to get some pieces together that we are ready to compare what we have with Java EE then when we look at things like what we have with Kubernetes and OpenShift. We'll slightly then go over and just give you some hints about tools or new tooling that is around. The list will definitely not be complete. There is so much happening currently in that space that even I have no chance to figure out and to follow everything. So if somebody of you have good idea or has some improvement for this talk, just come to me afterwards and we can see how we would fit. The last point, the sample project, everything I'm more or less talking to you today, I tried it out. It should work. I assume that we will time-wise not get to the sample projects, but it's on GitHub. It's called it's in the references part that you will find the link to the GitHub. So we start with some history. We go back for that really to the early days, where we started with, let's say, initial parts of some kind of abstract symbol and formula handling, which is the Babylonian writing. By the way, who does still use that kind of technology? Okay, why two hands? Huh. Great. And then obviously we have to scale somehow. So we started writing books. We then added the automation. And not so long ago, we had this kind, that's a calculation machines that even, that can calculate relatively simple things. It's not very fast, obviously. But it's we also things getting smaller. That's basically still a complete mechanical calculator. And then we have had the chance that we get in control about electricity. And I think things getting more usual now. Next big step is that we made computers to talk with each other, some kind of wiring then. And today, where we are today, I would say we are in paradise. At the beach with your notebook, with some wireless LAN. You have computers in your pocket that are so powerful that when you are standing around other computers that were used some decades ago, for example, in a defense area of armies or something like that, it's quite incredible because you can take your phone and say, okay, that system feels fills four rooms, and I have the same here, but with about four times the power and the speed. But what has all that to do with Java E and Kubernetes, you may ask? You are still in the right talk. No worries. History sometimes is important to understand the current. It's now we go back in the modern parts, what we had before Java was there. Some of you maybe not be born at that time. I'm an old fossil in the old stuff here. I was working with Java since the first version. But I previously also did that kind of stuff. Fortunately, not for too long. Writing 5 pages of C code just to make 2 machines say hello to each other. It was getting slightly simpler. We additionally had incompatible platforms, incompatible network technologies, so that was not really fun. And also, when you look at platform or just application development, there was nothing, something like that, that you had multi-platform libraries. There was one at the university written by Erich Gammer and some colleagues. ET++ was its name. It was written in C++ with, also here you see that abstraction, hardware abstraction layer down. Actually, when you tried that out on Linux, it seemed to work more or less. On the Windows, typically after 5 minutes, there was that famous segmentation fault and you were done. Nevertheless, that was great work done, because out of that project actually was the book written, the Gough pattern book about design patterns. That is basically the work that was leading to that kind of book, which definitely it has its significance still today. And then, that was why Java was such a success at that time. Because you get through multi-platform development tooling just for free. It was incredible. Before, you had hours of trying out things, you downloaded things, you were playing around with all that Pragma stuff, and nevertheless it was not really working. And Java gave you that all just for free. And even more interesting is also when you look at how it started, because originally, the guys were targeting TVs and coffee machines. That was their idea. They were also approaching then companies that were producing TVs at that time, and they say, "You're crazy, we don't need that." Today, every TV has some software in it. So they were just 20 years ahead of their time, James Gosling and the guys there. So they were thinking about what should we do then now? Because TVs and coffee machines, that seems not to work. The internet. Yeah, we do the internet. Because that was also the time when the internet was getting, let's say, more used. More used means you had a modem at home with not very fast accessibility, but everybody more or less that was a bit modern, had a modem at home and could connect 1 or 2 hours a day to the internet. And companies also, then for them, that was important. So the applet stuff was a great stuff. What was incredible good at that time, because before that you had JavaScript. One JavaScript language per browser, simply said. It wasn't working. Only for small cases, and now with applet you had a better programming language, you had an API, and you can more easily just program things that would move and were fancy somehow in the UI. And that was like a bomb that was there, that was incredible. And at the end of that, let's say first half year when Java was coming up, everybody that said, "I can write Java," could hire somewhere for 200 Swiss francs a day, the hour, sorry. Okay, so we had at that time that fancy part for UIs. Also, AWT was really a good thing at that time. And nevertheless, since we already had browsers and web applications. There was also CGIs and all that kind of scripts. We also wanted something similar for the Java world that we can more easily do server-side programming. And that was the time for Java EE. Actually, Java EE is quite old. The first version is from 1999. So it's technology from the last millennium. And every couple of years it was an update. Currently we are working on Java EE 8. Don't ask me when or if we see Java EE 9. That would be something I can really not tell you. What's interesting, basically what we have here is multi-platform for business applications. And that was the reason why it was quite fast also taken up by companies like banks, insurance companies for writing their applications. And good thing, it was still platform independent, more or less. It was depending on Java, and since Java was running on the most important platforms, that was a good thing. That gave you some kind of security for your money that you invested here, because this is much money at that time. In a nutshell, we have with Java EE, widely used middleware computing platform. First, initially, it was the Java EE architecture is more some kind of monolithic single server stuff. Not. I just will continue. Perhaps we can solve it. But what we have, we had a number of defined interfaces, how our software, our components written in Java interoperate with the container, with the runtime platform. Basically, even if you look at today at serverless computing, you have something similar. You have a very easy API, of course, and you just take code, smash it in the server, run it somehow. Okay. Java EE is a bit more complicated, but the idea is not that far away. When you look at the main components, we have an EGB container, which is running the EGB beans, a web container, which is running the servlets and all the technologies that build upon of it, JSF, JSP, all that stuff. Then we have a JCA container, which is some kind of an integration API to integrate and include foreign third-party systems into the container, into the Java container. And we have obviously also some kind of messaging integration with the JMS provider part. That's basically all. When we look at that visually, we have that kind of Java box could be separated in multiple instances, obviously, because it doesn't end up with just one instance. We scaled horizontally, we scaled vertically. We have some EGBs, which basically is some kind of module or abstraction for functionality we do. We have the web ports, which could be different servlets, different ports. And you could spread them across different VMs, but you don't have to. You can put all in one big VM, if you like that. If that is intelligent or not, it's another story. And you have some systems you have to communicate with, be it some external databases, messaging systems, or via JCA, for example, some external systems of any kind. You have defined deployment formats. You have VARs, RARs, EARs, JARs. And as said, you have some core services, I would say. You have some defined developer APIs where you can program against them. And the server must implements them for you. you have some kind of component isolation. When you have different EGBs or different archives, typically they are loaded in different class loaders. So there is some kind of isolation. Unfortunately, class loading is not defined by the standard, so it's different for each application server. That's not so good. You also have some kind of component isolation, meaning also even based on language constructs, like with the public or package protected stuff. That's kind of isolation. You have some kind of service location here, because you can, for example, annotate entries or fields and just say that interface is an EGB, and the container ensures that the right EGB then is injected there. You have some kind of lifecycle resource management. You have thread pools typically in an application server. Stateless beans can be instantiated multiple times. You have object pooling, something like that. Passivation of sessions is some kind of resource management. Obviously, we have some security and management mechanisms. And already mentioned JCA for integration. Nevertheless, basically, from an architecture view, it's more or less a monolithic architecture for me. Originally running on a single instance, and obviously be scaled because we have to. Comparable, I would say, even when you look at databases, at classical relational databases, same thing. It's basically a monolithic single machine architecture that's running there, which is very scalable and which is very powerful. But actually, when you do about replication, mostly it's one database that does the work. That just ensures that a replica is working as well. Since Java delivers some of this portable, basically all the system here is portable as well. Deployment and configuration is done relatively statically, typically via XML. And it was built for low to medium load. And when you compare it to non-blocking systems, I would say average performance. That's basically enough, as long as you have some controlled load, like it could be even a big enterprise with some 10,000s of employees. If you have set up your Java EE system cluster correctly, no issue about that. That will work. But if you go more outside, 24/7 mobile applications, IoT, all that stuff, where load can also widely differ, I would say Java EE will hit its limits. Nevertheless, that was quite working good. But then something happened. Containers. With Docker, we got a container system for code. That sounds cool. And good thing is, that solves portability. Now we can put everything we want, more or less, as long as it works on a Linux box, into such a container and deploy it and run it. That's great. But it's not so good for Java, because that was one of the unique selling points of Java. That's gone. That's the end. It's not the end of story of Java, but we can do things now that we could do only in Java beforehand. We have also with Docker containers, we have a clean and portable runtime environment. We have a relatively simple deployment format. If you don't have it done yet, writing a Docker file on your own, it's not that complicated. It's quite simple. We have additionally solved all the dependency and compatibility issues that we could have. It's even more isolated, and that is an advantage. And we also have mechanisms there. We can restart containers, we can control their resource consumption, so we have very, very interesting features for resource management that would, I would say, go beyond what we can do in an application server or in a VM environment. The overhead is quite minimal, and if done right, the startup basically, yeah, it depends what you have in the container, obviously, but it, when done right or small, it could be very fast. We talk about seconds. That sounds good, I would say. The question is, how do we run containers in production? You can use Docker tooling, Docker Swarm, like that stuff. But when you look at Docker Swarm, you will quite fast, I would say, hit also some kind of limits. But I don't want to have to start a discussion about if Docker Swarm is the right solution for you or not. Yeah, you can try it. Oh, much better. Thank you. So how to run containers in production? Yeah, we need orchestration, obviously. And there, after playing around with different systems, for me, Kubernetes and OpenShift quite probably will do the run. And what is that actually? OpenShift basically it's Kubernetes as well. There are additional stuff built in from Red Hat. It's open source. Both projects are completely open source. And Kubernetes basically came out of the experience of running containers in production from Google. At Google, it's called Borg. A few things were rewritten. Out of the experience that it should be built differently, and was open sourced by Google in 2014. What you get there is all the stuff that you really like. When you have multiple machines, you know, from time to time machines break. In the old days. Typically, one of the breaks could be because the hard disk was crashing, some head was crashing, end of the story of that hard disk, and obviously all that data on it is then gone. Typically, the machine crashes as well, and it's dead. There are also other things like water that can come into a calculation center. Many people think that's rare, but it's happening from time to time. We can also have power losses, even in Zurich. We have sometimes power losses where the whole power in the city goes away. It's not that much happening, but it could be more in the future. And what get with Kubernetes is we have all the cool stuff. So if we can start something, Kubernetes takes that container and deploys it somewhere, magically. If the underlying hardware where it is deployed dies, Kubernetes gets immediately aware of that and redeploys it on another node. From a client perspective, you will even not encounter anything of that. Or how many of you did ever encounter a failure of Google? Hands up. 2, 3, 4. So we have only a few guys or girls, I didn't see it with the lightning, that actually encountered a failure on Google, which is quite. It's extremely good because it's a huge system with incredible load and it just works. And you get the same here for free. So you get resilience, failover, as I told you. You get also auto-scalability. If there is more load coming, you can control. You know at the Kubernetes system knows the CPU usage, the network load, everything from each container. Then you can define rules that when you hit some limits, that you should start simply another container. And the system will, for you, dynamically configure the load balancers. that are reading. There is no human interaction needed for that. No admins that do some load, reset up of load balance or something like that. Also said that, obviously, when you all that things are in move and in change all the time, also routing must be automated. Service location must be automated because you never know where a node or a pod effectively is running. Network management even. Even the network, basically you have the physical layers, but typically your applications can run in their isolated network environment controlled by software-defined networking. So your network is basically running in software. Just imagine that. That's quite different to what you are used to typically if you have a traditional setup. Also given that, because that isolation on the containerization or the orchestration part is much better, you could even think of mix workloads on the same hardware nodes. Because via software-defined networking, you have a clear separation, and the other mechanisms with the containerization, you have clear separation. That may be enough from a security perspective. Maybe, because it's an arguable point if you want to go that far. But you basically, the system is built for mixed workload execution. So you just have hardware nodes, Kubernetes or OpenShift on top of it, and you run everything on it. Everything that fit that is able to run in a container. Special attention, persistence, because if things move and you write some kind of local files, and then you move the container, the files out of the box will not move with the container. There are mechanisms also for that, which are not. One mechanism is just to attach a distributed storage somehow to the containers, which then are there as well as when container moves. Or let the orchestration system ensure that the files you have written will be moved as well. That's some kinds of mechanism that is currently played with or in first testing phases, as far as I know, in Kubernetes in the upstream. Now, when you then compare, look at that and the big picture here. We have our Java EE container on the left side. On the right side, basically, we have a similar system, just realized with a Kubernetes cluster. So we may have two servlet applications. We also have there two servlet applications, but we have doubled them. And over each, there is a load balancer, which distributes the loads on the two pods. We have then for each EGP component, we have a component on the right side, which is running in its own container, which is also load balanced. It was too complex to just put in here some hardware infrastructure. Basically, you can have any combination how these things run on the hardware nodes. Could be two, three nodes. By default, Kubernetes distributes it on the different nodes. So it would end up each service would MS1 would be on one node, MS1 on the right side would be on another node. The same with two or three. But you can also tell Kubernetes what it just exactly do. What is also interesting when you look at the black lines, at the thick black lines. The thick black lines here are physical, typically manually configured connections, TCP connections. In the EGP world, typically we have our deployments on some servers. We have some configuration where we have entered IP addresses or DNS names in the base case from the other components we access to. So there's typically much static and much manual work involved somehow. We have then our database, our messaging system, our third-party system. On the right side, basically we have some kind of, or let's say physical connections typically on the top, because we have some IP how to enter the Kubernetes cluster. the database is here on the left side, that is not accidentally outside. That is, it's a real big, big database box with incredible of data, and nobody in your company is willing to move that into some, or is able to move that kind of data into your container. So it stays outside of the container world. Why not? Obviously, for connecting then outside of the outside of the container to the database, you have some traditional physical addresses because you have to get access to that database. But everything that's happening in the container, it's completely automated. It's running in software, actually. It's managed by Kubernetes completely. And even if your messaging system is container enabled somehow, why not running it as a container as well? The same with your third-party system. If it fits, it can run in a container, run it as a container. If not, let it outside. But that shows you quite good the possibilities, the differences you have. And obviously, when you now look, let's say, at the web part above, now you get even more load on that web one container here. Yeah, then we can simply spin up another web one container. And if it's then if the MS2 service needs more load, we can simply spin up more MS2 containers. We can do that defined by rules, and then it can do that completely automatic. And that could spin up, could be even mean than spin up across more hardware, because Kubernetes will try to distribute that typically on different nodes. But beside that, if your nodes run on hardware, or if your nodes are some hypervisor VMware proxies for Kubernetes, Kubernetes does not care. It works with all kind of stuff. You don't need bare metal if you have some kind of traditional setup in your company. You don't have to change all that setup just to use Kubernetes. You can reuse that. So basically, our modules that our new modules then have are the containers. We get scalability, load balancing, failover, all the stuff, the nice stuff. We get also data center awareness. So if you have multiple data centers, we can either tell Kubernetes he should not spread across data centers, but more useful, we can explicitly tell Kubernetes he should ensure that applications are always then deployed across data centers. So if one data center goes completely offline, you still have the other one. As containerization is the basics of all that, we have much better isolation on I/O level, on storage level, CPU level, and also on the networking part. In a Java VM, for example, when you have some kind of out-of-memory issue, the whole container basically must be restarted. There is no guarantee about Java, what's happening or what's working anymore. Basically, you have to kill the instance and completely restart it. With a container, you restart the container, that's it. The same with restartability. If something is getting out of control, it's much more complicated in Java EE to just restart it and you are sure that nothing else is affected. When you look at Akka, Vertix, and such kind of systems, it's a bit more simpler, but still you're running in one VM where some guarantees are simply not there because of how the VM works. And if you want to definitely go the microservice path, obviously container fits perfectly to that. But additionally, finally, you also get with some kind of new tools in contact. So we can compare it even. Oh, that looked the best this morning. Okay, be it. when you look at component isolation, in the container world, you have containers, SDN, you have the quota stuff. On the Java side, you have class loaders, you have the language features, package protected, public, private, all that stuff. With Java 9, you get modules. That's nice. Lifecycle management, in an EGB container, you have CDI that does part of it. You have the EGB container which does it, and obviously you have Java VM, all the memory management, garbage collection, all that stuff. On the orchestration layer, you have basically the replication controllers, and you have obviously Docker, which is running underneath, which is doing parts of it. Scaling in the EGB world, typically more statically, typically configured. On the right side, we can have it dynamic and software controlled. Routing, similarly, it's obviously mostly it's dependent on the setup you have exactly with DNS, but it's more or less also more less flexible than what we have here. Service location, basically, also here you can think of Java, the JNDI of Java references. Typically, you also can have some configuration in your configuration files. Whereas on that right side, you have the possibility going over the DNS mechanisms of the container, or there even are REST APIs that you can call in your surrounding Kubernetes container, which help you to resolve the references to the instances you want to get in contact with. And there is also with Fabricate, there is a kind of a Java API just wrapping around them, which is quite simple. Obviously, resource management. On the Java side, we have garbage collections, threatened object pools, and on the right side, we have basically all the mechanisms that were around in the Linux world: CPU, memory, network, I/O. That's quite good. So, advantages of containers, Kubernetes: we have really a working isolation and modularity. We can much better scale and load balance things. If you have resilience mechanisms which makes us independent from the hardware. Also things not mentioned as of now is Kubernetes supports you with doing partial updates, rolling updates, and also if something is not working, you can roll back with one command or even automatically your deployment. Do that with an application server, it will not work. You cannot do that with a Java EE server. It's not built for that. We have defined health management mechanisms. In Java EE, you also have some kind of management, which is defined how you can access information about what is running inside. But here, you can even go one step ahead. You have also some hooks where you can have health checks. And if the health checks signal that something is not working, the container will reload the components automatically or redeploy them. That also is then things that is out of box in Java EE in that kind of form not there. Data center awareness, definitely it's one level above the Java EE world. Again, technical are also important for me as an enterprise or architect is technology independence. It's not required that your containers are running in Java. You can use whatever you like or whatever matches your problem the best. With Java, you're bound, and Java EE, you're bound to Java technology, obviously. I still love Java, and I'm quite sure I will get retired still using and writing Java, but I'm nevertheless open to other things. But there also are some challenges. We have additional tools and technologies. How many of you really do not only know Docker, but really have worked in deep with Docker? I would say it's less than 5%. Now imagine and think of whole companies that want to try to get to that path. there's still lots of work to be done, of education, of just getting on that train. With Docker, you have Docker as tool. We will see later some kind of what functionality is there on a bird's view. We also have really now to understand the Linux systems and the networking underneath. If you don't understand TCP networking and what's happening, or even HTTP, when you write REST communication, for example, between the components, you will sooner or later be somehow lost. There is not only, you cannot only stay in your let's say some kind of protected Java world. You have to go a bit out. But for people that are doing just writing some simple backend EGB components since 20 years, it might be a challenge. When you talk about containers and getting them into production with running that kind of container orchestration engines, you also have some cultural clashes. If you go to companies and say, no, that whole system, that's a system on your own, we installed it here. And how you configure the firewalls, that's nothing for you guys in the network team. That's on its own. You don't have to do anything there. You should not. You must not. That might be create some interesting discussions, let's say. And also on the development part, when you go more than the DevOps way, you build it, you run it, you have also to do some additional thinkings on how you should do things and responsibilities, and how also this will quite probably also affect somehow your project organization. Conway's law, it's not just one thing written on paper, it must have some kind of reflection in your organization at the end. And even from a technical side, when you go the microservices path, microservices means basically decoupling, that's a very good thing. Decoupling and information hiding, that's something defined and firstly talked about by Parnas. It's, I think, 20, 30 years old. Now we have basically the technology to do that and to enforce that. But in our brains, typically, and the reality is quite different, and I think it will take some time until we get there. Even there are lots of questions opens, especially in the persistence area with the databases, how we should do that, how we should get in decoupled our application logic from our big shared database layer, which with multiple or with single schemas, whatever, but basically it's one big coupling API on the base of our solutions. So let's talk a bit about tooling. As said, we have Docker as the deployment format for containers. There are other containers as well. Docker is the most used one, so I will just stay to that. With OpenShift or Kubernetes, we have that kind of manifests that are files, JSON files or YAML files. We will see an extract later. These are the new, let's say, deployment descriptors that we need, which defines how many replicas we want to have, the labels that we can find them later again in the system, something like that. We can also think of OpenShift as kind of new application server, because we build components like we build EGB, and we now deploy them into that new world. So some kind of, for our thinking, basically an OpenShift cluster is like an application server. You can also have their namespaces. A namespaces let you then keep your pods and servlets and artifacts that you deploy within that namespace. So you have some kind of isolation, like and which then maps basically to your project or your solution, something like that. You can also use namespaces for isolating on stages. That it's a different option you can do. But it's also an important concept. Then you will have some kind of integration. If you decide to go with orchestration solution and deploy your, for example, Java artifacts into that orchestration solution, it makes sense that you then use Fabric 8 and all that stuff, for example, as libraries to get service location and such mechanisms. But nevertheless, Java is still a good thing to write your microservices and your components. There is also beyond Java EE, very interesting stuff happening. You can use Vertex, for example. It's non-blocking. Okka. And also my example that I have on GitHub basically rewrites a Java application with Vertex in the middle side, and on the backend side, I just replaced the complete JPA implementation with Hibernate, which still is JPA, but it's a bit more flexible. And because I didn't want to go down on the whole plain JDBC APIs. Look over the fence, you have other technologies that may be interesting. Now, when you look shortly about what could you mean that in tooling side, you see here that are all the commands that you have when you run Docker. That are the different Docker commands that you have on the first top level. It's quite a lot. OpenShift, these are all the commands that the OpenShift command line has, first part. Second part. That is an OpenShift or Kubernetes manifest. It looks simple, but the tooling support that helps you to fill in the right values, it's still in the early days, I would say. If you know what you do, it's simple. If you don't know, it could be quite complicated to find the right information, because when you Google it, you will find information on older version of Kubernetes or OpenShift. Sometimes it matches, sometimes it has already changed. There are some tricks how you get to a good template that is working. Good thing in OpenShift, there is nice things there. There in OpenShift you have that build to image, where OpenShift, you can tell into OpenShift, just here is my repo. Basically, OpenShift looks at the repo and says, "Oh, there is a Java. There is a Java main class, so I can build a Java container with that." Or I see a Docker file. Oh, that's good. That's a Docker build. I know how to build Docker, so I just use that and automatically create a deployment and the image a stream in Kubernetes, and I can then directly deploy that. The good thing is, with the Fabric 8 Maven plugin, you can actually connect your Java project quite simply with that build-to-image chain. In the most simple case, when you have some kind of single jar, you just add the Maven plugin and just can say deploy. And if everything else is set up as described, which is not that complicated, you can deploy directly into your cluster. Also, OpenShift or Kubernetes, you can run it locally. There is a MiniShift, for example, for OpenShift. There is also a MiniKube there. It's simply a binary. You can download it, and then you can start it on your machine. And basically, it should configure more or less everything. Could be that, I don't remember it, that you have the OC, the OpenShift command line, must install it as well, but it's not more than 10 minutes or something like that, 5 minutes to do it. Fabric 8 itself has on one side a big development platform, which I will just ignore, because in my experience sometimes it works, sometimes it works not. Works sometimes better with Kubernetes, sometimes with OpenShift. That's the plugin I mentioned. So you can just simply use the plugin and let the plugin figure out what it should do. Or you can even map and tell the plugin that it should that you have written your own Docker file, or you can also map the Docker structure into the Maven structure, configure it, and then the plugin knows how to build it, the containers. There are lots of plugin goals there, building, pushing. Helm, it's an interesting, Helm is a repository format where you can put and store your whole application as in a repository, like a Maven artifact. That's also quite interesting. Unfortunately, currently it works good for Kubernetes, but it works not so good for OpenShift. Lots of goals here, and because time is running away, I only have 30 seconds, I have seen. We go further to the summary. Java will not disappear. But when you compare functionality with Java EE, the Java EE infrastructure aspects basically are much better covered by what you get with Kubernetes and the containers, in my opinion. Portability is definitely also given for non-Java ecosystems now with the container technology. The complexity which is coming to you that you can profit from all that should not be underestimated, culture-wise, but also from a technical standpoint. But I think it's worth doing it and going that path. Combined with that, microservices, for me, it's definitely a good thing, but I'm also aware of all the decoupling. Decoupling is not a simple thing. We did not get to do it right in 20 years. I don't know how long it will take until we really get really decoupled systems throughout all tiers. So improve your skills, and finally, most important thing, when you're playing around with new stuff, it's always fun. Have fun. At the end, just references, there is the sample repo where you see that mentioned Java application. It's already there, you can go right away. And that is the end. 1 minute late, I would say that's okay. If you have questions.
I've seen that Kubernetes can help with the managing of configuration, not only the bytecode, the software. Can you tell us something about strong and weak points of this solution?
The good thing is when you do configuration via Kubernetes, you have versioning with it. Obviously, it's aware of your containers, and it basically it can inject even files, and it can change it. And if you have a configuration change, Kubernetes then can trigger a redeployment automatically. That would be is the advantage. The disadvantage is you can only test it basically. Really, if you run in a container, it's a bit more responsibility that you give away for a configuration again, also to the orchestration solution. I'm not so. The good thing is that for secure aspects, because also the secrets are supporting security aspects and encryption of the stuff. It's definitely, I would say, a good thing. I'm not sure if you should also use it the same way for application configuration. I'm just open to it. Yeah, or we can do it afterwards. I'm still. Okay. Yeah. Okay.